back to another episode of Human Humane Architecture, broadcasting live from the opposite ends of the world, which is Honolulu, Hawaii, which you see in the background, and in the outskirts of Munich, Germany. And my co-host is as mostly DeSoto Braun. Hi, DeSoto.
Good day to you, Martin, and hello to Germany.
Thank you very much. And let's jump right into the first slide and clarify a little bit what's going on, because the background we're seeing currently is a virtual one, but the pictures we're showing on the images we're showing on the first slide are showing sort of a current condition, but a while ago, and explain a little bit the circumstances, what we see on that slide.
Well, in the picture on the right is the view from Yor Lanai at the Waikiki Grand Hotel looking towards Kuhio Beach. And Joey and Clara, your son and daughter-in-law, were staying there after you'd returned to Germany, and they were wishing they could go to the beach, but because of the COVID-19 lockdown, they were prevented from doing so by the Honolulu police crew patrolling on the sand in their ATV vehicles. So all they could do, Joey and Clara, was look out longingly towards the ocean. And back home in Berlin, where they live and where they've now returned to, they go on their lanai in their apartment, and interestingly enough, it looks over the water as well, but it certainly isn't the Pacific Ocean, because it's a river, it's a cold river, and you don't want to swim in that, unlike the appealing Pacific Ocean.
That's true. And actually, one of their most exciting trips before they had to fly back, sort of last minute heading out, was actually driving up to your place and pass on the our PI mobile studio that you kindly keep for us.
Yes,
and ever
right.
Since then, that was the most exciting last trip, and then they were locked down on Milan 9.
That's yes, true. That's right.
So hi, Joey and Clara. Hang in there. We're all on our lanais and hanging in there.
Yes.
And let's go to the next slide, because we want to look at potential post-pandemic production propositions. And while on this one, where obviously now I moved away, we can see two symbols. They're very symptomatic for what runs our island, literally and figuratively. And what are these?
Well, looking out onto the ocean in the big picture, you can see two ships or boats. In the foreground, the small white boat is a tourist-related activity that takes people out off the shore of Waikiki. And in the far distance is a bigger military ship. And those two vessels symbolize the foundations of our local economy. Number one being tourism, and number two being military spending by the federal government. And what we're facing right now is the complete shutdown of tourism, into which the Hawaiian Islands are now have the worst, highest unemployment rate in the entire country of the 50 states. We have 37% unemployment because of the lack of tourism. So at the moment, our biggest source of income is going to come from the military.
And that's most tragic and ironic, because we used to have the most records in the other direction. We had the lowest unemployment rate, about 2.7 or something percent,
right?
And talking figure is actually, you said number one and number two, but they're actually, as far as their power economically, tourism and militarism are actually pretty close to each other. So while we're all concerned, and we will continue to talk about our most obvious tourism, today we will shed a light on the other one, which is militarism, and maybe we come up with some interesting ideas that can potentially help at least our minds get away and out of the crisis for a little bit. The pictures at the top is also that we were both very shocked about, well, the many shocking things our president is doing, and one is directly towards our discipline, and this is wanting to mandate, we're talking about the federal government, which the military is organized by, is that he wanted to mandate federal buildings to be of classicist style. And we're saying this is a silly idea, as many of the ideas he has being silly.
Yeah.
So
right.
let's go to the next slide and think about that. We always like to get as personal access to the subject matter. because it's about us, because we're not narcissists as the president is, but has encouraged you, the audience, to think about yourself and what access you have. So in this case, we want to make you think about, you know, your family members, relatives that have been in the military or are in the military. So what was I sharing with you regarding my access to that, which this picture here is showing?
Well, the picture in the upper left is your grandfather, is your father's father. And he was killed during World War II, obviously in the German army, when he was on a ship that was torpedoed or sunk in a fjord in Norway. So your grandfather, you never knew your grandfather. Your father didn't remember his father because he was too little at the time he died. And right underneath that is a picture of the young Martin Despang himself with the kooky haircut. And you and I were saying, how did you get away with having hair like that in the military? Because usually the first thing they do is shave off all your hair. But you were in the German military because you were drafted, because there was a mandatory national service thing in effect when that happened. And then you have your full military experience, which then in turn had something to do with the work that we're about to talk about that you subsequently did to the military after you were out of the army.
Yeah, and there's Joey again, looking a little younger at the very bottom right. And at the time I had to, we had a draft when I was age 18, and that was 15 months was the time of service, and I added 9 more months to make a little mini career of lieutenant in reserve. While signing up, we were doing nothing more than being a defense army, because we had screwed up pretty badly before that, so you guys weren't trusting us more than to do that. But in that short period, we were actually asked to join you guys, the United States, and myself, since I'm American, a couple of years as well, on top of my German original nationality. And at that point, we're asked to join America playing world police. And my ex-wife at that point said, wait a minute, that's not what we were signing up for. And I don't want to see you go to Iraq or Afghanistan, wasn't the thing yet, but, you know, soon later. And she said, why don't you question that? And we did it, and we were called in, and must have made our case so convincingly that they basically said, this is it. This is it. You're done. You never have to come back. And, you know, Joey, of course, you know, was the reason for that, because she was worried. You know, if I would be sent out there, I don't come back. And so Joey had to grow up without a father, which unfortunately my father had to. And that's the reason, because the rules are that if your father has died in the war, that the son doesn't have to go. So it wouldn't be too much of a hardship for the mother who already lost a major male in her family. So all that being said, let's move on to the next slide, because what does it have to do with that? Some years later, we were actually asked by the federal government, and that's the one that Trump again wants to mandate everything to be chaotic in style. We were asked to design a military diner in former East Germany, and it was some years after the reunification. And this is something that supposedly is top secret, but now I'm a pacifist, so I couldn't care less. And you can't really read that much out of that, because that's that's like the base plan. That's like the camp plan. And it's just a lot of lines, a lot of infrastructure there. But we were asked to design a cafeteria for the military, for the German women's wear. And the program is very prescribed, especially the what they call the kitchen block, where all the meal preparation and all the kind of the dirty areas and the clean areas, everything is prescribed down to what you said, you know, the appliances and the faucets and the refrigerators. So there's nothing to design, but what you can design is the dining hall. And the Army's pretty much order was, you design a box where we can feed our war machines. And we immediately said, no, we don't do that, because I have been in that club, and this is about all the young men, you know, who have to be there, and they have no choice. But it's already a very intense time for them, that they're under pressure. and they're sort of imprisoned and have to do things that someone said, and it's about potentially, you know, about wetlands and all these things. So we said, if anything, architecture has to help. And so I think they're going to make it the nicest restaurants that you could think of. And they were like, you're not doing that. I said, we're doing that because you chose us for whatever reason, which we actually really never found out. And I said, you know, you give us the budget, you give us the program, you give us the timing, we got to be within any of that. But the architecture, let that be our problem. And so one sort of odd thing in this location we thought is great, that actually, you see, I put in the north arrow up there, so north is up. And to the south, there's a road that actually cuts, a public road, a public access road that cuts through the bases. And we thought it would be great, if not physically, but at least sort of from an atmospherical way, when you're dining, you can look out, you can see or imagine the road where your fiancé is driving by. And so it gives you a little bit of that feeling of freedom. So let's go to the next slide and check out how that project could have played out, and share with me your impressions about what we came up with.
Well, what you pointed out was that the kitchen area was a given. You could do nothing with that. But what you did do with the dining area, as you said, was turn it into what looks like a very elegant open space, which one whole wall is glass. You've got louvers that come down maybe about two-thirds of that. So during the winter, this is a solar heat collector. And during the summer, when it's warmer, those louvers will help cut back on the amount of heat coming into this big room. You also were told in this room that there had to be a separate dining area for the officers. And you made a little enclosure or a separate room for them. And then when this was actually built, they looked at it and said, well, we don't want to sit in this separate little room or the separate enclosure, which you can see in the picture there. We want to sit out where it's open and looks the nicest. And the other big thing that turned out here was that you made this big empty space that also, as you can see in the top picture, is large enough to accommodate other events when they have parties or when they have holiday gatherings that other people are invited to. So it turned out to be something that was added on to the basic requirement that made it a lot more special.
Yeah. It's something that Jay is always keen on, and, you know, obviously that doesn't get compromised a lot in our current corona sort of scenario, but it's public and it's civic space, so we wanted the building to have a very civic appearance, so not at all hermetic and enclosed and defensive, but actually very open and very democratic, right? And as you also shared in the program, we not only were we pacifists by that time, but we also wanted to sort of democratize the typology. And since I have been at the lowest rank of building officer, I try to tell them, I said, you don't want an extra room. You want to be with everyone in this great wide open space, at least on the roller coaster, and this is obviously an homage to that. But they were stubborn and didn't want to listen, and then finally when it was done, they got it. Why? So go to the next slide and check out, because this is what you were recalling, that the building is almost like Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. The top picture is from the north, which is a kitchen block, and the more you come to the south, it basically opens up. We put a little reference picture there at the top left, and this goes to our friend Ron Lindgren, who's going to be with us soon again to share with us more of his partner and friend at Killings Group work that they did together. And it reminded us of their campus work, right, as far as prescribed materiality.
Well, you were told when you were given this job that the building that you were about to build, this cafeteria, was required to use this particular type of red brick that was already in use on this army base. And you said, we want to do something different and have the grout between the bricks also be colored red. And their first reaction was, oh no, we will not do that because we just are free of the influence of Russia, which used to control East Germany, and they required everything to be painted red. We won't do it. And you had to do a mock-up of what it would look like in order to convince them that it wouldn't look like this Russian red, but in fact would be the building that you see here now, which does have a uniformly red facade.
That's true. Let's jump to the next slide, which is illustrating what you already were talking about before, which is the environmental statement and sort of attitude of the building. You see that section on the bottom right with the sun angles at different times of the day and the year, and we're specifically calibrating the wooden louvers to let the sun in the winter time, because we're talking temperate climate to majorly heat the building, while in the summer the sun would be kind of kept out. And that's something that, you know, you already said that one would wish that the military would approach more, and in fact the whole nation and we as a society, which unfortunately has the many things that Trump and his administration locked down. Some say, and I just heard an interview with a virologist who said Corona is still a relatively, not a problem compared to the big climate crisis we're facing.
That's right.
And so we said rather than mandating a style which is just about surface, maybe one should mandate substance. And for example, high energy efficiency in military buildings.
Yes.
And as this building demonstrates, and we did that just around the millennium, the turn of the millennium, and it wasn't prescribed yet. Soon later, the German government and, German clients started to actually mandate and require. But this building is sort of a pioneer, using a military term, as far as being post-fossil and bioclimatic, because it was doing that because we thought we need to do that as the 21st century being the generation post-fossil era.
Right.
So we worked the client pretty hard. As you were saying, not only, was it pretty much, a pacifist club and the military people, but it was also East and West Germany, so there was a lot of things clashing into each other culturally and ideologically. So we wore them out pretty much after that. And let's go to the next slide, surprisingly for us. Okay, before we go there, this is a picture here again about the wood louvers having been installed freshly. It is a picture soon after it was completed. But the pictures on the right side, what did we talk about when we looked at them?
Well, one of the things is that you can see that there's an article included there that says France's timber mandate, and that means that the French government is mandated that government buildings or more buildings are going to have to use wood that can be locally sourced and is renewable. So the beauty of wood is that, as I said, it doesn't, you can grow more trees. So we don't run out of it. You don't cut them all down and then have no trees anymore. So this is something that should be and is already happening in France, that at least I think should be happening in the United States as well. Much more of this, a sense of renewable things that we should be using.
Yeah, and that was initially actually sent by our founding uncle, Jay Fidel. We said, how about that? And we said, yeah, if you mandate something, you better mandate something that addresses a challenge in the 21st century and the potential, and rather than going retro and mandating a style, which we shouldn't have anymore in these days. You mandate maybe a building material that's has the potential to be the most ecological around. And so
right.
We like President Macron's over President Trump's mandating. Right?
Yep. And you also pointed out your family name is actually from France. It's a French name,
yeah.
Last name.
Yeah.
So mm-hmm. along with this wine, which is illustrated in the upper right corner, which has the same name, a similar name as you do, you have a French connection.
French connection, yeah. Maybe we're ahead of the game and already sort of hearing what Macron will say about two decades later, actually.
Right.
So let's go to the next slide. Because although we wore them out, actually, about several years later, about 7 years later, they came back to us to design another one of these military cafeterias in the same region, but still far enough away. And this is the impression again. And it's once again, it's as our methodology is designing inside out, so it's not about the form, it's about the space. And here it's again connecting the people eating with the outdoors and the outside, and then the form it sort of naturally takes on is the one we see above. But let's go to the next slide, which shows us a little bit about the context, which there wasn't one. There was actually, this was almost untouched land. There was a couple of former GDR concrete roads, and then there were some of these sort of buildings that were sunken in the ground and were grown over by vegetation. So the bottom one is a study model that we quickly made and thought we were going to sculpture the building sort of out of the ground. And the next slide is talking about the making of it, which is always as important, equally important to us when we talk about the thinking of buildings. And what are the sort of issues we see here on that slide?
Well, first of all, in the upper right corner, there's a picture of a particular type of fairly new, I think, concrete. And this concrete, which you see in the background of the picture behind you and your guest in earlier shows, has essentially air bubbles in it. It's like a sponge. And this aerated concrete is extremely useful because, first of all, it's lighter. Second of all, it has insulating properties because all those air bubbles help keep the concrete from changing its temperature too much to get too hot or to get too cold. And it also harkens to the Volkswagen thing, which is illustrated in the upper left corner, because you had one of these during your time in the military. You were able to work on it and modify it in a military garage. And the thing about the so-called thing is that it was created as a military vehicle during World War II, but then it lasted, of course, into the 20th century later to be sold to the public in the 1970s and 80s. And one of its aspects is that it is really a basic type of construction. It uses this corrugated metal body, which adds stability and strength to the basic metal because it's got this corrugation impressed in it. But it also is really stripped down. And it's very basic, and it's very honest because of that design. So
yeah,
I think that that's what you're alluding to.
That's true, and the little picture basically shows hippies in there. So we're thinking that the drawing at the top left, we didn't do that, we found that, but we found it intriguing. If someone can capture the notion of that car just with lines, with lots of lines, it once again supports what you were talking about, essential nature, and that was a motivation, not to say inspiration, in a non-literal way, to say you make a building that is so simple and robust that just like the car, although it's made for something negative as to be made for war, it should flip its meaning or have a double meaning, a meaning by basically then be, you know, become a symbol of freedom and democracy, right?
And you use this type of concrete. Didn't you use this type of aerated concrete, did you not? Martin, are you there?
That's absolutely right. I'm still there, yeah. I had to switch headphones, sorry. Yeah, and the guy who looks like he's my guest, he was actually my host. This is our hero, our fellow host, Howard Wake, with his one of the longest standing shows called Green. And so I call him Mr. Breezy Easy, and he was very intrigued by that material. And we were talking in another show that the main, which our hope is with prefab concrete from Great Pacific Rocky Mountain Precast up there in Kapolei in Campbell Industrial Park, Les Camper is their president. One of the first things he asked me when I first met him about 8 years ago, and he heard I'm from Germany, he said, oh, do you know autoclaved aerated concrete, which is the technical term for the material we're talking about. That, again, we're thinking that I'm studying to introduce to the island because of its properties that we were talking about, of having an R value, so it keeps you cool, while at the same time, the critters and the termites don't like it and they don't eat it, right?
Yeah.
So many advantages for that one.
Yeah.
Let's go to the next slide. We're almost at the end of the show, but we want to maybe close on this note here because we have done a couple of shows in the past that were promoting, again, a post-pandemic pandemic proposition, which is actually taking you and other interested people to where I'm from and where these buildings were basically built, and evidence-based design, life cycle assessment, you know, analyze them and post-occupancy evaluate them, and maybe take home something of that. And again, maybe our sort of mission is now that while tourism is down, the military is still there. So maybe we can go and educate the military, work together with the military, sort of humanize the military, of course, have our graduates, you know, to work with them so that secures their jobs. But again, in the transformation, and your hopes are high up, and I want to make this the closing note. You're saying when hopefully the era of the current president is concluding later in this year, what are you hoping for that this can plug into?
What I am desperately hoping for, and I think it's very plausible, is that with the elimination of Donald Trump and many of the Republican enablers that he surrounded himself with, we will get a new outlook in government where not only will the bad things that he did be undone, that he's done to the environment, but we'll also see the federal government, for example, mandating, as you said, in these European countries, construction techniques and materials to make us less energy wasteful and to go in this new innovative direction and to innovate again, support innovation, and get us to where we are in a much better place for climate change and environmental destruction, etc., so we're not worrying about it as much.
Mm-hmm. Lovely closing note. That is getting our spirits high up. Much appreciated, DeSoto.
Thank you.
And we have to conclude here. We're going to elaborate a little bit more on the post-pandemic potential of militarism and then also tourism again in the volume two of this show. So until then, please stay very little militant and very humane and
healthy.
Human, right? And healthy.
Yep.
All righty. Thank you.
Bye.
See you guys next week. Bye-bye.